about you, but about four or five or six of us are up here crying. This is beautiful. Would you all do a favor for me? Just go like this. Take a deep breath. Go. Thank you. That's going to help all of us. Thank you. I want to welcome a much beloved group of friends and family from a much loving couple that are so grateful that you're here today. Let us open in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for days like this to celebrate many days that brought us to this and many days that are going to follow this. We give you thanks for all right now. And we pray, Father, that as we speak your word and celebrate with this couple, that you'd put something in every one of us of yourself, that we'd see you more clearly, love you more dearly, because of this great example of two loving people and a loving Jesus that brought them together. I pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to remain standing for some worship songs that we're going to have and for the intent of marriage. Who gives this woman in marriage? It's no time to move slowly, Tom.
I'm sorry.
You're doing great.
It's good. Tom and Cherise, marriage is God's picture of eternity. The Bible records creation being crowned by the first marriage, the beautiful story of Adam and Eve. History closes in the book of Revelation with the still coming mystery marriage of Jesus and his bride, the church. Those who are followers of Jesus are looking forward to a great marriage feast. Marriage is designed by God to demonstrate both his character and the destiny of those who respond to his love. As equally valued partners, the husband is to lead and to love. The wife is to respect that leadership and respond to that love. Marriage is given for the joy of mankind and the glory of God. Marriage is thus to be entered into joyously, but soberly. Given this understanding of marriage, are you prepared in body, mind, and spirit to enter into this great privilege and sacred covenant? If so, answer, we are.
We are.
You have some worship songs in your bulletins. Could you join the wedding party and singing these?
Shining in the light of your glory.
sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see. Trinity.
You may be seated. John, would you come up and read the scripture for us? Brother John.
A reading of John. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you these things so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. This is my commandment. Love one another as I have loved you.
Cherise, you look absolutely beautiful. And Tom, that's a very nice suit. Well, a lot of times we don't get a chance to hear the whole story. And I don't have the whole story, but I've got some of it. I want to tell you some of it. They met online. They're a little sheepish about that. But that's where they met, at something called Coffee Meets Bagel. Is that right? Okay. Pretty good matchup, coffee and bagels. For me, tea and bagels. And I understand that it was kind of a difficult thing for you to go online. She's an independent woman. She's confident. She doesn't need a man. Not need. She's happy, single. That's the way everybody should be before they get married, or marriage is not that good. Just a little warning to those of you who think you need to get married. But her sister, Lacey, Lane. I knew I'd make some mistake up here with names, so there, that one's done. Okay, Lane. You helped, right? Yeah, yes. Okay, so she went online and just put it out there and took one in and never looked anyplace else. Tom was the one. It worked. She didn't have to go fishing around. She knew quality more than the suit there. Quality when she saw it. So anyway, they had some coffee together and they had some common interests and common goals in life, and they both knew the Lord, and so that was good. And they had a date, and then Tom went home for Christmas. Was that just a year ago? Two years ago. Went home for Christmas, and then he flew back to Phoenix, and where he studied and worked in church and done several things. Mom and Lane suggest pick him up at the airport. Is that right? That's what I heard. That you guys kind of thought this might be a good one. Pick him up at the airport. Well, she's a very cautious woman, and rightly so. She's a treasure, and with no pride in it, she kind of knows that, which everybody should know, that you're a treasure. And so it's not going to be an easy thing to convince her to go further, but they did. They had, like, a bunch of dates after that. I mean, a bunch, like 15. And then she had to go back to New York. She had two work locations, New York and Phoenix. So she had to fly back to New York. Well, Tom was a little concerned about this. And he cautiously wanted to know. He said, well, before she left. Now, you can correct me if I get this wrong, because I took pages of notes on this thing. And she said, oh, I'm not sure. That's true. Okay, you can say that's true anytime I hit it right. But then the next day she came back and she said, I changed my mind. And he said, playing coy, about what?
That's true too.
That's true. Okay, good. So anyways, they started chatting. Snapchat and other ways. Wednesday nights?
Wednesday night.
And those chats went on for like 5 hours. They did. For a good period of time. Tom sent letters, thoughtful little things. I mean, he's not just a good man, he's smart. And then he was going to visit New York. Well, this is a big deal. I want to come and see you. She got nervous at this point. This is like, could get serious on me. He's a good man. I really like him. He looks good in that good suit. And other things, but she wasn't sure. So, but she took off work for 5 days. That said something to him, too. Well, they went all around New York and just, they really had a marvelous time. And then, of course, he had to go home. She said, I was nervous, but I enjoyed it. The closeness, they held hands. That was sweet. He wasn't overly aggressive, but holding hands, she liked it. And she loved, she got flowers. He was thoughtful. And they loved worshiping together. And she said, he sings. Now, I've heard him sing. And for her to love singing with him, yeah, this is another thing.
Amen. Amen. Yeah.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. I mean, I love Tom, but everybody has their gifts. Okay. So then they came back here and they went camping frequently together. And she asked other people, have you gone camping with Tom? Now, he's a very aggressive camper. He likes the tough places, really, and long walks, like umpteen miles. And she asked other people, have you gone camping with Tom? And they said, yes, once. He's a tough camper, but she is a tough cookie, and she liked it. And they went, and she said, I would go places with him because he was so spontaneous, but everything was planned. He planned the contingencies. I felt protected. I felt safe. So I went to these places. With one place they went, what's it called, the Slit Canyon?
Slot Canyon.
Slot Canyon. Slit, slot. Okay. So a Slot Canyon is one where you can see air up there, but it's a long way up, and a flash flood will kill you in the Slot Canyon. And there's water down there, and you can't see things because it's muddy, and Tom leads her through a Slot Canyon with mud up to their hips.
True.
And she followed because she trusted him. And they both love adventure. And really, this marriage is about adventure, and I'm going to talk more about that later. But as she was happily sloshing in the mud, she did so, and I just read this, because I trusted him, and I want to go wherever he wanted. And the day that he took a job at school, I went in and asked for a transfer to the Phoenix office. And it was approved in 48 hours. So on their sixth anniversary of officially dating, that must have been months. Sixth anniversary is months, okay. I never, you know, we never celebrated 3 months, 6 months. These millennials just do things differently. And he got, when she moved back, he got big brownie points with the parents here because she's back in Phoenix. So that was another positive thing about Tom, right? Okay. So they took a trip to Puerto Rico together. And during this time, Wayne and Beth, would you guys wave at us? Wayne and Beth started to do pre-marriage counseling, which I recommend. Once you're committed, it's pretty hard to turn around. But if you get some pre-marriage counseling with this, I'm talking to single people that might be here, or if you've got grandsons or whatever, do the counseling before you make a commitment, because then things come out and you can adjust or quit before somebody gets hurt. So they did that with this wonderful couple here and helped them through that. And at one point, Tom, they like to have good discussions. And he said something like this, we need to get gloves so we can get in a boxing ring. And she said, she may turn red again, because she did as she said this. She said, oh, that's not the kind of ring I'm looking for.
True.
Is that true? A good line, huh? That's true too, right?
That's
all right.
True.
So then Tom said, and there's other things here, but I think I'll let it. Tom said something like, well, do you want to go ring shopping with me? And you know what she said? Well, you got two choices. Anybody want to guess? That's right, or I wouldn't be asking the question, right? She said no, but you know why? She wanted it to come from him, not her. And so she was going to believe that he knew her well enough to choose something that would bless her. I like that. You know, that, for those of you who did it differently, there's no condemnation, but I kind of like that. I kind of like that. So at this point, I would like you guys to enter into a short play for the rest of this time, because sometimes weddings can get boring, you know. But so we're going to have a little play here. But it's going to be a very serious play, and I'm going to read something from the Bible as we transition from the natural to the spiritual. We opened with the discussion that your marriage and all marriages are really an illustration of Christ and his bride, the church. And we kind of pass that off because we're so interested in this life. But I want to read something here. And please, I want some of you ladies just to restrain yourself. Do not walk out as I read this passage. Please, just stay seated and just stay, hold on to your chair. Because God talks to women before he talks to men. You know why? After Adam and Eve, God always addresses the women before he addresses the men. This is a test. Do you know why? I think it's because women listen better. And when women do their part, the men gradually come. But the women's part is not easy. It's not easy. Because here's what it says. And I'm reading from the same Bible that says Jesus died for your sins, from the same man who taught us. And this is what he said. And it's not cultural. It's eternal. No, it's temporal, because it talks about something eternal. It's temporal. Do you know that in heaven there's no marriage? This is a temporal thing that we're having here. It's temporal. I've been married 47 years. It's going to come to an end. Good or bad marriage, it's going to come to an end. It's temporal. And in heaven, there's no marriage or given in marriage. The male and femaleness drifts into eternity. So here it is, though, for time and for the parts we're supposed to play within a marriage. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. What? He ain't God, folks. Certainly, Stella's husband, that's my wife, he's not God. Why in the world should she submit to me as if I'm the Lord? That's a pretty strong statement, wouldn't you say? That's a pretty hard part to play for these 60, 70, 80 years that you have on earth, and maybe 40 to 50, maybe 60 years within a marriage. That's a pretty hard part to play. This guy does not know how to treat a woman, which most of us don't, guys, so. But wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is head of the wife, as also Christ is head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let wives be to their own husbands in everything. Now, so I just want you to see this beautiful woman here as the bride of Christ, as if she is the bride of Christ, and she is keeping herself pure to give herself only to one husband, Christ himself. That's what the picture is. That's what the picture is. Now, Tom, then you're given an assignment. You may think, now, Dad, could I have what you've got there? Pat? Ah, have you been king of your house, Pat? This is wonderful. Thank you for bringing this today. It's Happy New Year. I just bought it at party time, but I want you to have this. If you can hold it or wear it. That's your choice. He's going to wear it. Okay.
Perfect.
Okay, if that falls out, it's okay. So you're to be. This is wonderful that you're the king of your house. But you know what? There are two parts to being the leader. There are two parts to being the leader. And if the women would really focus on what the man's part is, it would not be so hard to see this submission thing and to say, okay, God, I'll do my part. Because here's what the man has to do. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church. Wow. That's my job as a man? Uh-huh. Are you sure you want to get married? Are you sure you want to love like that? You're supposed to love the world like that anyway, but you have one person to pour it out on as Christ loved the church. Okay, that's a pretty big order. And gave himself for her. Wow. That means Mary Kay before fishing lures. That means a car for her. That means, wait a minute, gave himself for her. Whoa. That means maybe no cards on Friday night with the guys, but a date with her. Wow. This looks different than what a lot of men think. Like, I'm the head of the house. Well, you are. But there's a responsibility for that head, and that's to love like that person has never been loved by anybody else, including their own dad and mom. That he might sanctify her and cleanse her with the washing of the water and the word. My job with Stella, my wife, is to see that every relationship she has, to lay down my life, that every relationship she has is good. And that she herself feels accepted, that she feels beautiful, that she feels, and I'm not perfect at this, so it's easy to talk about it, believe me. And she's not here today, so I can do what I want. But and the washing of the water of the word, that we so speak the word of God to our wives that they understand. They understand the love of God and that they don't want to behave in ways that are ungodly. They want to please that man and to please God, and their lives change because of the love that's poured out by that husband. So I've got one other prompt. Perry, could you bring me that one? So here's the other thing that goes with the crown. It's the cross. Jesus gave his life for his bride, and that's what men are supposed to do. And I happen to know this man's going to do it. That's fine. That's fine. The cross and the crown. I mentioned that marriage is temporal, and I talked a little about submission. You know, submission is such a misunderstood thing. I had a secretary once. And I was the boss, so she needed to submit to me. So there's submission for all of us. Every man needs to be submitted to God. Jesus Christ himself was totally submitted to the Father, obeyed him in everything. Everybody on earth except God the Father must learn submission, or life does not go right. So my secretary was Carol Cover. And Carol was about 5 feet tall. She's getting older now. She's probably about 4'9". And but spunky as ever. She was her own woman for sure. She was not a yes sir person whatsoever, but she was thoughtful, kind, and submissive. And she came to me in my office one day and she said, Gary, in fact she always called me Pastor Gary, which is not necessary, but she said, Gary, Pastor Gary, I've written down 10 things that I think you ought to do differently in the church. And I submit them to you. And then she said, and now I submit to you. And I believe that that's what submission is. It's not keeping your mouth shut. It's saying what you know to be true and helping that king, that leader, that husband to make the decisions for the family, and you're making them with him, that will guide that family in a godly, safe way. So I spent more time thinking and reading about this than just about anybody. So anyways, the adventure, going back to your adventure, they both love adventure, and something is necessary to have an adventure in life. One is good leadership. That's absolutely necessary. The other thing is trust, to trust in that leadership. And there's one more thing that's necessary. Charles Schultz. Everybody watch or look at Peanuts cartoons? They're pithy little cartoons that really told a lot about life. So one time, Charlie Brown was laying, looking up at the stars, and he was getting some advice from Lucy. And he was saying, why is there suffering, trials in the world? Why does God allow there to be suffering and trial in the world? And Lucy wisely answered from James. She said, because it helps make endurance and patience in you. And Charlie Brown asked the next logical question, why do we need patience and endurance? And Lucy answered, so you can go through more trials. And that seems like a nonsensical answer, but it's true. We get little things in life that challenge us, little things that irritate us, little things that seem like big things, and they're not. Big things are loving God and loving people. Those are the big things in life. Money, houses, cars, scratches, broken, wrong color. Those are all little things that most people miss the big things in life because they pay too much attention to them. This couple's going to pay attention to the big things. So there are three things that's necessary for an adventure in your marriage and as a couple in the kingdom of God. It's following the leadership of your husband and together following the leadership of the Lord. To trust your husband and together to trust the Lord. And endure through the things that are not always working out the way you think. A lady went to heaven in a dream or reality, and she told me these two things. She said, I saw two prizes, two stacks of prizes. And the woman asked the Lord in this dream or vision, she said, what are these two stacks of presents for? And the Lord said, well, this is a stack of presents, of gifts I wanted to give people. They never asked for them. They never asked. You have not because you ask not. And I couldn't send them because that's the requirement, that they ask. So, well, what is this other one for? And the Lord said, oh, those are gifts that I sent, and they returned because the people were not waiting for them, and they'd left the place of waiting. If we don't endure and have patience in life, we will not see the gifts and the treasures that God has for us. And you're on a treasure hunt now. You are on a treasure hunt. Every person is a treasure. Every event is a treasure. Because God says, all things work together for good to those who love the Lord and to those who are called according to his purposes. My single mother-daughter just texted me and she said, Dad, it's leaking again and I think there's mold. And the thing you fixed, I'd spent 6 hours fixing the plumbing. It's broken. What are we going to do? Well, there's a treasure in that because I'm going to spend time with my daughter. And instead of thinking, oh, nuts, another problem, I thought, wow, there's a treasure here. I can show my daughter I love her, and I know I can fix it. And the Lord knew that, and I could have fixed it the first time, but I need more time with her. And she's a busy real estate person. Sometimes it's hard to get time with her. But with broken plumbing, she'll spend time with me. So I just commend to you the adventure that you've started out with and that you continue to grow in leadership, in trust, and endurance. Amen. Could I have the wedding party join us? Tom and Therese, everybody's familiar with the words that you're going to say, but they're more than formal words. And I have a chance to speak to a lot of young men and women, and especially young men. And it used to be, and some of you older people remember, when it was said, a man is as good as his word. Remember hearing that? It's a true statement. Everything God says he'll do, he does. We're in the image of God. And Tom, these are some of the hardest words for most men to keep. But they're the most important. You've given your life to Christ. You've asked him in. That was the first most important thing that you've done. And the second is to covenant with this beautiful woman. And likewise with you, Charisse. So, Tom, if you're ready for this, which you said you were, but you don't know what's coming. If you'd repeat after me. I, Tom, take you, Charisse.
I, Tom, take you, Charisse.
To be my lawfully wedded wife.
To be my lawfully wedded wife.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer or poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
In good times and difficult.
In good times and in difficult.
Forsaking all others.
Forsaking all others.
For as long as we both shall live.
For as long as we both shall live.
Before God and these witnesses.
Before God and these witnesses.
I pledge you my life.
I pledge you my life.
And Charisse, if you would repeat after me. I, Charisse, take you, Tom.
I, Charisse, take you, Tom.
To be my lawfully wedded husband.
To be my lawfully wedded husband.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
In good times and difficult.
In good times and difficult.
Forsaking all others.
Forsaking all others.
For long as we both shall live.
For as long as we both shall live.
Before God and these witnesses.
Before God and these witnesses.
I pledge you my life.
I pledge you my life.
Tom, do you have a symbol of this vow that you've made?
Yeah.
Could I have that, please? And she likes this, right?
I think so.
I hope so.
Tom spent a lot of time thinking this through, and God, wow. But there's a reason it's a ring. In the Bible, it never says give a ring, necessarily. There's symbols of marriage that Scripture and every culture has. This is our culture, and it's a beautiful one. Number one, it costs a lot, and it puts value on this beautiful woman. Number two, it's in a circle, which says something about unending love that you're promising to her today. So if you'd take this ring, Tom, and put it on her ring finger, and say, with this ring.
With this ring.
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
And you have a symbol of this vow you've made. Could I have that too, please? This didn't cost as much. I don't know why that is, but I don't. He's valuable too. Okay, if you put this on Tom's finger, Tom, with this ring.
Tom, with this ring.
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
At this point, we're going to have prayer from Wayne and
family.
And the whole family, yep. and the wedding party will come up. If you would lead us in that prayer, come on up, Wayne and Beth.
Tom and Charisse want to thank you for giving us the privilege of praying at your wedding ceremony. What a joyful day this is for all of us as we have heard the vows and shared in the excitement of your marriage. When we would meet with Tom and Charisse, often we would end our time of talking and laughing and crying and all the things you do in pre-marriage, and we would pray together. And we prayed as bookends. My wife prayed first, and then I would pray at the end. So I'm going to ask Bev if she'll lead us in a prayer.
Thank you, Lord, for the joy that we have had the privilege of just experiencing this beautiful wedding. Just the joy of seeing you bring Tom and Charisse together and to see them now surrounded by their family and their friends. Lord, I pray now that they're married that they will continue to put you first in their life and first in their marriage. And as they enjoy this love relationship with you, they'll have the firm foundation that we sang about just at the beginning of the ceremony. And Lord, as they live in your love, I pray that they will learn to give your love to each other, a love that is filled with forgiveness and steadfastness and for grace and for mercy and joy. And I pray that for them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Excuse me, I need the mic. Thank you.
To love you, join as one, and let our love grow as your love grows in us. Bind us together so we learn how to trust in you. Trust in you. Saved us inside. Now together we want to serve you. So Lord, use our lives as we journey from here, and make our love strong, yet gentle and true. In all that we are, let us glorify you. Ooh.
seated except for the wedding party. Now, it's my great pleasure to introduce to you for the very first time, Mr. and Mrs. Tom Croke. And if you haven't done it before, you can kiss her now.
First time.
There will be a reception line, so we'll be a little bit of time getting out. The usher will dismiss you, and then you're all invited to the reception following this wedding, and the directions for that reception are in your bulletin.